So tonight, I'm going to speak about how you can enrich your postal addresses with Elastic Stack, and I'm going to share my screen before I forget about it. Yeah. And the purpose of the session is to say, let's say that you have some information in your information system, like you have a name and an address, like this one, where you have the number of the street name, the city and the country, and you want to know exactly where, what is the location of that address, that postal address. So you want to retrieve the geolocation point, like the latitude and the longitude for that. Or the other way around, you have a location somewhere in your system and you would like to know what is the postal address that corresponds to that point, actually. So this is exactly what I'm going to speak about today. So I'm David Pilato. I have been working at Elastic for more than 8 years. I'm going to start my 9th year at Elastic in January. And I'm Dadoune on Twitter, so if you want to follow me, you can just follow me. I will share after the presentation a link to my speaker page where you can get back the information that I'm going to share with you tonight, and specifically the repository that I'm going to show you in a moment. So you can just follow me and then I will tweet about this link as well. So I'm working at Elastic. This is what I told you. And by the way, you probably noticed that I have this lovely French accent, and I'm based in France, near Paris. I'm French, so that's why you have this lovely accent, as people are saying. Anyway, so I'm working at Elastic, and at Elastic we are working on open source projects, and those projects are mainly Elasticsearch. So this is the heart of what we call the Elastic Stack, and this is basically where we embed Apache Lucene, and where we are able to index billions of documents and retrieve all those documents in real time, search across multiple nodes, et cetera, et cetera. So it's an extremely powerful search engine with a REST interface and what have you. So very powerful, very well known now. On top of that, you have Kibana. Kibana is a UI where you can talk with Elasticsearch and do reports, and we have specific application depending on the use case that you want to cover with Elasticsearch. Or like if you are in the security thing, then you can have specific security application to understand what is happening on your system. If you are on the observability part, then you have specific application for that in Kibana, and all those things that you have. We have an ingest layer named Bits. So Bits is a way to collect information from the source. It can be logs, for example, so lines of text that you can stream with FileBit to Elasticsearch. And then you can enrich those lines inside Elasticsearch and visualize that in Kibana. And we have also Logstash. Logstash is an ETL where you extract the data from a source. You transform the data on the fly, and then you can load the data to a destination. So you can read, for example, from Bits, do super advanced transformation in Logstash, and then write into Elasticsearch. So this is basically what the stack is built from. And then we have several services that we are providing on top of that. Tonight, I'm going to start from this repository where I have all the code running. So if at some point you want to play that again by yourself, then it would be super easy to fork this repository and follow the guidelines, and then you will be done and you will be able to replay all what I'm going to show you, hopefully. So let's start. So we at Elastic, we are also providing a cloud offer, which can run on AWS, on Google Cloud Platform, on Azure, and other providers, where we can deploy Elastic as a service. Specifically here, I have deployed already a cluster named Banno. This is the one I'm going to use. And it's a simple cluster that I deploy, only one instance for Elasticsearch and one instance for Kibana, but obviously you can do different things than that. And you have automatically the latest version available. You can upgrade your version in one click. This is something that I did yesterday evening, so hopefully the demo will be fine. We'll see. So you have here Elasticsearch and Kibana available. So let's start with that. So let's say that you want to index postal addresses. And because I'm in France, we have a very nice project in France, which is using OpenStreetMap behind the scene and contributing to OpenStreetMap as well. The name is Bano. So Bano stands for National Database of Addresses for France. And they are publishing every day a new extract of the postal addresses that they have collected. And this is what you can get from here. So if I look, I already did everything locally. So here I have all the CSV files that I mentioned. And if I look at a CSV file, so this one, for example, this one is coming from my department. So we can see that we have here an ID, then we have the street number, the street name, the zip code, the city, the source of the information, and then we have the latitude and the longitude. And with that, we can easily see that we can connect a postal address with coordinates. And to do that, the first thing that we need to do is to actually send that information into Elasticsearch and index that into Elasticsearch. So this is exactly what I want to do now. So to inject that into Elasticsearch, I have a simple script shell here that I have. So what's the name? Horizontal. So basically, this is going to copy the first line that we have here and pipe that into curl JSON shell script here. And if I show you what is this thing, it's basically posting on locally on that port 8000 a JSON document where I have a field named message. And in this field message, I'm going to paste actually the content of the line. So I'm just going to send that line within a JSON document, within a message field, to this service, which is running locally. I'm going to show you in a moment that. So I'm going to clean here. So let's execute this curl raw sample. So something happened here. And if I look at the other file window here, I can see that my service, which is running here locally, I'm going to show you exactly what it is, has published an event here. So this is what you can see here. You can see the message field that I mentioned, and you can see also many other information which is coming from the service which is running. And here the service which is running is Filebit, actually. So I mentioned already Filebit. Filebit is a way for you to collect logs, information, but you can do many other things than that. So let me show you exactly what is the Filebit configuration here. So I have here that Filebit config.yaml file. So here I activated a new input in Filebit named HTTP endpoint. And by default, it's going to start an HTTP service, which is listening on the 8000 port. So it's enabled. And what I'm doing here, I'm also using some processor, so which means that in Filebit, you can also transform a bit the data before sending that to the next destination. So I'm basically renaming the field JSON.message to message, and I'm dropping the field name JSON. So this is what I'm doing here. And then the output, you can see that here, I'm going to send that inside Elasticsearch in an index named BanoTest, using what we call a pipeline, an ingest pipeline named Bano. So how did I start that? So I have a filebit.sh file here. So I'm using Docker behind the scene here. And because I'm running in cloud, I'm providing to my image all the information about the authentication. With the demo, if you want to run the demo locally and you don't want to run on cloud, then there is a Docker Compose script that you can just start, and then it will automatically go through that one, which is going to work locally, actually. But here I want to use the cloud platform. So I have that. So let's open Kibana now. So in Kibana, I have several tools, and one of the tools that I want to use is what we call the DevTools. DevTools is super helpful when you want to send queries to Elasticsearch without using curl and all the ceremony that you have to do. So here, what I'm going to search in the BanoTest index, and I'm going to run a simple search here. I can see that I have one document, and this is exactly the document that we have seen just before. Okay, so this is what we have. But for now, the document is indexed as it was presented by Filebit. And what we need to do is to actually transform that document to get rid of all the information that we don't need, here timestamp, ECS, host, input, and agent, and also parse the message field to extract meaningful information from that message field. Right, it's a CSV line, and we want to extract that information. So to do that, I mentioned before that I'm sending through an ingest pipeline named Bano the document. And if I look here in the stack management part to the ingest node pipelines part, I have indeed a Bano pipeline here that I can look at. And as you can see, it's totally empty. That's the reason there is no transformation yet, because I'm not doing anything yet. So what we need to do, we need to actually edit this pipeline and provide more things. So I'm going to manage that and edit the pipeline. So here I need to first add a first processor. So let's add a processor named CSV, because I want to extract from the field name message. And I need now to specify all the fields that I want to fill with the content of the message field. So the first one is the ID of the document. Then I want to have access to the address.number, address.street name. Then I want to have address.zip code. The next one is the city, so address.city. And then I have also the source of the line. And then I have the geolocation point. So I want to generate a location.lat for the latitude and the location.long for the longitude. Okay, so let's add this. So here I have added my CSV processor that you can see here. And what I can do now is to test actually this pipeline with this new processor. So to do that, I'm going to copy paste this it here as a source document. And I'm going to add it here and paste it. And then I can run the pipeline. So for the line that we just saw, we can see now that I have an address object with the zip code, the number, the city, and the street name, and also the location, the longitude, and latitude within the location object. So what we can do next? We need to actually remove the non-needed field, because we have a lot of noise here. We don't want to inject that information in our documents. So let's add a new processor. I'm going to use here the remove processor. So all what I'm showing you tonight is a very brand new, it's happening in the 7.10 version of Elasticsearch. So this possibility to edit super easily the processors in Elasticsearch. So let's remove the fields that we don't need. I don't need the timestamp field. I don't need input, I don't need ECS, I don't need the host, the agent, and I don't need the message anymore, because I have parsed the message, so I can drop that raw field. So let's add it. And if I look at the output again, we can see now that I have only the information that I need here in the source document, which is the location, the address, and the source. Okay, so we are almost done. There is something wrong though. Here, you can see that the longitude and the latitude are actually strings and not numbers. So one of the things we want to do now is to actually convert those strings to a float. So let's do that. We can add here the convert processor, and from the field location.lat, I want to make that a float. I'm adding that, and I'm going to copy this one, edit it, edit it. And instead of doing that on latitude, doing that on longitude, update. And if we look at the output again, then we can see that I have a right information. So everything looks correct to me. So what we can do now is to save actually this pipeline. Okay, so this is the definition of the pipeline. So you can obviously define all that within a JSON document and send that to the REST interface, but here I just shown you the interface to do that. So we are done with that. So now we can run again the pipeline. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to remove the index here, and I'm going to send even more data and make sure that everything is working well. So I'm going to add again. So I'm going to pipe that, those 10 lines here, to the curl JSON thing that we saw before. So let's do that. If I look on the other side, I have seen that those are the lines that I just sent to Elasticsearch. But if we search now for that information and search again, we can see that we have only the transform information. So we went through the pipeline and we were able to transform the information before indexing that into Elasticsearch. So with that, we can now start to search. So this is exactly what I done. Now I can search for the street name, for example. Give me all the documents where you have core maze in the street name. Okay, so that works well. So that could solve one of the use cases that we have. We have an address, and we want to get back the latitude and the longitude, for example. And the other use case is we want to search by geolocation point. So for example, let's say that I'm at this position, and I want to get all the documents which are within a square of 1 kilometer around this location. So let's launch that. This is failing here. And why we have an issue? We have an issue because here Elasticsearch tells us that the location field is not a geopoint field. What happened behind the scene? Elasticsearch tries to automatically guess what is the mapping that we want to use for the document because we did not specify anything. So if I look at the mapping that has been generated, this is the default mapping generated by Elasticsearch. And here, for the location point, for example, you can see that Elasticsearch is seeing that as a location object with two other inner fields, latitude and longitude, which are float, which is correct. But for our use case, we want actually location to appear as a geo point. And to do that, we need to apply the mapping that we want to use. So let's change the mapping and force Elasticsearch to use the mapping that we want to use. So to do that, you can do that in the index management part here of Elasticsearch. You have access to index templates here, and we don't have yet an index template for the dataset that we mentioned. So I'm going to create one. An index template. I'm going to call it Bano, and I'm going to apply that at every single index that starts with Bano. So Bano test, for example, we will apply this index template that we are just creating. So next. And then one of the cool new features that we have in Elasticsearch recently is the ability to compose your templates with what we call component templates. Here, for example, I have defined a component template named Bano settings. It's already in my cluster. It provides me index settings. And if I look at it, I have a simple things here. What I'm saying, I just want to have one shard, which means one Lucene instance for this index, and zero replica, because I'm running on only one host and one machine. I don't want to replicate anything. So I can add this component templates to my index template. And then I have this Bano mapping. Bano mapping comes with index settings and mappings as well. So let's open this one. If I look at the settings, what I can see is that I define some settings for the analysis process. So anytime you are going to index a text in Elasticsearch, it's going to go through and be processed by what we call an analyzer. And this analyzer is built of different things, and mainly a tokenizer and some token filters. So I wanted to define a token filter named Bano synonym here, which is of type synonyms. And here I'm defining some synonyms for this token filter. So anytime I will have BD, which is an acronym for boulevard in my text for the streets, instead of indexing BD, I want to index boulevard. Anytime I will have AV, instead of indexing AV, I will index avenue. Same for R, which means rue, and same for RTE, which means route, road. Road, street, avenue, and boulevard. So this is the synonym filter that we have. I'm just looking at the comments. Does this possibility to edit the field type imply an index mapping in Elasticsearch can now be changed in Kibana? You cannot change live an index mapping, but you can create an index mapping. That's the only thing. You still have to re-index the data if you want to change a mapping. So basically, you would change the template, create the new index. The new index will have this new template as a base for the index settings and the index mapping, and then you will have to re-index. If you don't want to manage that by yourself, we have a cool project named AppSearch, which is available with the basics free license and on cloud, obviously. And this thing helps you to basically change the mapping live, and it will re-index for you in the background. So that's one of the things you can do that by yourself. Okay. There was another question. Is 8000 the default port? Yes, so this is the default port, and you can change that port if you wish. So coming back to my settings, now that I have my token filter, I can use it later. So I'm going to define two analyzers. The first one is the Bano City analyzer that I will apply to cities, obviously. And the token filters I want to apply are lowercase and ASCII folding. ASCII folding because in French, you have diatrics, and instead of having a E with an accent on it, you want to index it as the ASCII, as its ASCII representation, which means that if someone is searching with the accent or without the accent, it will work at the end. And I'm using the standard tokenizer here. And for the street, what I'm doing lowercase again. I'm using elision. So elision is also a specific thing that we have in Italian and in French, where we need to remove some part of the text. Again, ASCII folding, and then the Bano synonym that I defined before. So this is the index settings that I have. And then we can look at the mappings. And here, I set the mapping for Elasticsearch. So I'm telling Elasticsearch, don't try to guess for me. I know exactly what I want to do. So for the zip code, I'm using a keyword type. For the number, I'm using a keyword type as well. And for the city, it's a text data type. And what I'm doing, I'm using the Bano City analyzer that we saw before. And also, for the city, what I'm doing, I'm providing a city.keyword field at index time, which is of type keyword. So the type keyword is often used when you want to compute aggregations, like give me the top 10 of the cities that you have in your data set. Or if you want to sort by a city, then you need to use that keyword data type. So I have two different use cases for the same content. One is the full text search here, and the other one is more for analytics and sorting. And then I have the street name, where I'm using this Banno street analyzer that I mentioned before. And then look, the location point is now of type geopoint. And this is exactly what we need. So let's apply this one as well. So I'm going to add it. So now I will have those two components applied. Next, I don't want to enter any other settings. Here you can also define field names manually if you wish, but I'm not going to do that here. No aliases here. Next, and I'm going to create a template. So here, you can see that I created this template, and if I want to have a look at this, this is basically the combination of all the components that we have seen here, which is available here. So let's remove now the index name Banno test. So you can see that you can do that here as well, like delete the index. Okay. And we can generate again some documents and make sure that our system is working well now. So let's reindex that. Here, same thing, same content. And if I look again at my DevTools, if I get the mapping now, I can see that the mapping that I want has been applied to my index. So I have the right mapping. And I can search again and now check if the geodistance works. Yeah, so that works now. So I fixed the problem that we have, so I can search now by distance. Very cool. So let's remove even more, documents. So instead of indexing only the 10 first documents that we have seen, I want to index the data set, all the CSV file that we have seen before. So to do that, I'm going to edit my 5-bit configuration that I shown you before here. And I'm going to enable this one. So this one is typically for the log use case, but here I don't have logs of lines of logs. I have lines of CSV, but that's basically the same thing. And what I'm saying, I want you to send all the content of all the CSV file I have in my Banno data directory. So let's save that. I'm going to stop 5-bit, and I'm going to restart 5-bit again. What you can see here is that the process has started to harvest the content of those files and send all that to Elasticsearch. So if we look at the Banno test again index, we can check how many documents are coming. So we have that number of documents so far. Here. So this is increasing. Okay, so I have 22 million of documents to index. So probably we don't want to wait for some hours here. So I have indexed everything already in another set of indices here. And I have those 22 million of documents available. So from that, I'm going to start from that. So let me stop the process because I don't need that anymore, the 5-bit process. Okay, so I have those documents. Yeah, so I done that. So we can start to have a look at what I have indexed. So for that, I'm going to show you a bit of Kibana here. So here you have now a nice search bar, which is super cool. We know how to search in Kibana now. This is super nice. So you can search, for example, for my Banno dashboard, which is my dashboard of my 22 million of addresses. I created here a top, top 100 values, the top 100 departments where I have the most postal addresses here. And here you can see some information about those addresses, like the number of documents in this region, for example. And if I zoom in, it will compute more and more information. So this is powered by a feature named Maps that we have in Kibana that you can use for free. It's available in the basic license. So use that. You can use that. So let's solve the use case that we have. So I mentioned that we want to do two things. We want to search for a given address and find the location point if we have an address. I can see that we have a question. You need a reindex in order to change the mapping and the existing thing. Yeah, true. That was not a question, right? So we want to, let's say that I have a user, like I'm a call center, for example, and a user tell me that he's living in 6 Allée des Myrtilles in Cergy. So this is the thing that I can write in my query. You can see that I have some diatrix here, by the way, the E. And what I want to do, I want to search for that content within those three fields, the city, the street name, and the number. And what I'm expecting is to get the most relevant information on the top of my list, whatever the size of the document that I will have. And what I want to do is to retrieve only the first document because it will be the most relevant one. So if I'm searching for that, I can see that as the result, I have 4 million documents as the result because 6 can match many, many addresses in France, probably Day and Myrtille as well. And I have a lot of addresses in Cergy as well. So probably that represents that 4 million of documents. But the most relevant document that I have is this one, is 6 Allée des Myrtilles in Cergy, which is the right one. And so we can just get that location point now and enrich the data set that we need, or display that address on a map if we wish. I can change the size, so you will see here with size 2. So the first document is the one that I mentioned, and the second one is 6 Allée des Myrtilles, but in another city, not Cergy. So this one is less relevant, as you can see by the score, than the first one because Cergy was matching as well. So which is cool. This is one of the use cases that we want to have. The other use case is that we want to search by geopoint. So to search by geopoint, we want to get the most relevant point, which is closest to the point that we are searching for. So here, this is one of the points. Let's say this is a user who is in the street and we want to have the closest shop, I don't know, that you have closest to the location of this person. So here I can do a sort by distance and get the first one, which means that I will get the closest point that I have in my data set around that location. So if I'm searching for that, I can see that it takes around 1 second to search for it. But what it does behind the scene, it's actually sorting 22 million of points. Here, I'm sorting 22 million of documents. Of course, I'm getting back the closest one, which is like 3 meters away from the point I was searching for, which is OK. I'm sorting by distance, but unfortunately, I'm sorting 22 million of points. So it's not super efficient, and that's the reason it took me like 1 second to compute that. Instead, what you can do is to first filter by distance around a square of 1 kilometer. This is what we have seen before. And then just for the remaining points, sort by distance. So that will be much faster. Like here, it's 38 milliseconds, for example, to compute that because I'm sorting only 2,500 points, more or less. Right, so I still have the same information, but this is a way to narrow down that. You can optionally control that even more. Here you can see that I'm searching within almost 100 shards, which means 100 indices actually, because I split all my data sets per department. So I have one index per department. If I know the department in advance, it means that I'm going to query only one shard, which is even faster. Here, I still have the same number of documents, obviously, in that area, and still the same result, but it's much faster. So those are ways to make sure that you are running your stuff fast enough. So with that said, what we can do now is to think about enriching an existing data set. So I have already a data set indexed named Person here. I have 100,000 documents which have been indexed in my data set. Those are people which are generated randomly in different cities, in different countries, and what have you. So here I'm just looking for people who are living in a city named Sergin, and this is where I'm living, by the way. So here I have that number of hits, like 6,000 documents, which has been generated randomly. And you can see those documents here, like this is the source. I have the name, the date of birth, the gender, the children, some marketing data. And I have an address here where I have the country, the zip code, the city, and the location point. I don't have the street name. I don't have the street number. Those are the information I'm missing. And what I would like to do now is to actually enrich this data set using the Banno data set that we indexed before and try to enrich our existing data. So to do that, I'm going to first launch in the background something because it's going to take some time to start. So Logstash has started. So I'm going to show you the configuration of Logstash that I'm using. So I mentioned that Logstash is an ETL. So you have an extract, transform, and load features. Let me show you that. So the extract part is done by the input part in Logstash. So basically what I'm doing here, I'm reading from Elasticsearch my index person, and the query I want to run is the query that we have seen, where I want to query all the documents where the person are living in Sergi. And I want also to extract the metadata because I need the metadata here. The transform part is the filter part in Logstash. So what I'm doing here, I'm also calling Elasticsearch again, and I'm using this query template that I'm going to show you in a moment. Is this one? And I'm querying all the Banno indices. And what I want to do, I want to get back from the Banno information, from the address.number, we want to put that in the address.number, same for the street name, the same for the zip code, and the location point, we want to override the existing location point that we used to have. And then I want to remove some information that I don't need anymore. And the output is Elasticsearch as well. I want to basically read from Elasticsearch, enrich with Elasticsearch, and then write into Elasticsearch again. I'm going to write in an index name, the old index name, which is person-new. This is a way for me to do that. And I'm going to use the same ID. This is a way to retrieve the metadata information if you wish. So let me show you that Logstash config. No, it's not this one. It's query. Yeah, it's this one. So this is typically the query that we are going to run. And as you can see, this is exactly the same query that we have seen before. But here, instead of having static data, I'm injecting the data which is coming from the person that I just read with the input part. And I inject in that in the query here as to do this square filter around my latitude and longitude, and then sorting by distance. So normally, yeah, everything has been started in the background, and we can probably start to see effects. So here I have this person new data set, hopefully. As you can see, I have that number of documents coming. And so now I have 3,000 documents. And I can search for those documents. And if I look at the result set here, I can see that the document that I had before are people who were living in Sergi. And now I have the street name, the number, the location point, which has probably changed, and the city name. Maybe this city name change as well. So we have that data set, which is going to be enriched on the fly here. we can have a look with again the map application in Elasticsearch, what our dataset is looking like. So here, this is the map of Sergi. In green, you have the original dataset, and in blue, you can see the corrected dataset. So green are basically fetching information from the person dataset, and blue is fetching the information from the person-new dataset. Okay. So obviously, I can zoom a bit. And you can see that I was generating data randomly because I was generating people here in the middle of the lake, which does not mean anything. I don't have anybody living in the middle of the lake. So maybe we can try to find. So let's see this one. Let's try. So here we have Asa Maxim. Let's filter on this one. Okay. So here, that was the previous location of Asa Maxim, but actually, this has been transformed. Asa Maxim is now living 59 Chemin de la Voirie, and this is the exact coordinates where we have a street a number in the street, so we have a location actually. Okay. Something also interesting. Let's remove that one. Here I have the city of Vauréal, as you can see, but I have some documents. Like this one, Marine Idris, for example, who is living here. If I filter on this one, okay, I can see that this one is actually living here in that house. So here, if you look at this address, so the first address was the city name was Sergi, but this has been corrected because now, oh, it's still Sergi. I'm sorry, I'm not in the right place. I forgot my geography, so this is the limit actually. So I need to find someone else. Sorry, that was not the right one. But here, so let's take this one. So this one is in Sergi, but this, oh, what did I do? Something is wrong in my, Okay, so I change. Just before the session, like in the afternoon, my demo, and I probably did a mistake. So you should have seen, I'm going to fix that after the session, but you should have seen here that the city name is actually Vauréal and not Sergi anymore. That's my bad. You should not change a demo just before the session, but okay, things are happening like this. So that's all what I have. I'm super sorry for the Zoom bombing, but this is things which are happening. So I'm going to stop sharing. And if you have any question, I will be super happy to answer. I hope you enjoy the session and you discovered a lot of features that we have, what you can do. All what I shown you here is available in the free basic version. I did not show you anything which is where you have to pay for. So everything is available for free.